supposed to bow my head, say amen, yeah, that'll do. Making every dead end look like heaven, like being okay is the way to reach you. But you're not afraid of all the things I feel. So why am I afraid of being real? You want my tears, every messy word, every scar and every fear. You want all I have, with no holding back when I'm high. At my worst, you meet me there, cause you see the beauty in my broken prayers. In my broken prayers. You don't care if it ain't poetry, cause all of my edges, they're a little rough, but that's not a god of me. Cause you're not afraid of all the things I feel. Don't have to hide the scars, they're still unhealed. You want my tears, every messy word, every scar and every fear. You want all I have, with no holding back when I'm hurt. At my worst, you meet me there, cause you see the beauty in my broken pride. My broken prayers. Mascara running down my face, desperate cry in a dark place. You take me that way, all of me. You want my tears, every messy word, every scar and every fear. You want all I have, with no holding back.
Fight a little longer, my friend. It's all worth it in the end. And when you've got nobody to turn to, just hold on and I'll find you. I'll find you. I'll find you. Just hold on and I'll find you. I've walked among the shadows. You wiped my tears away. I felt the pain of heartbreak. I've seen the brightest days. I've prayed prayers to heaven from my lowest place. I have held your blessings, God, you give and take away.
No matter what, how your grace is enough. No matter where I am, I'm standing in your love.
On the mountains I to the one who set me there. In the valley I will lift my eyes to the one who sees me there. When I'm standing on the mountain, I didn't get there on my own. When I'm walking through the valley, I know I am not alone. You're God of the hills and valleys.
God of the hills and valleys, hills and valleys. Make your way to your seat. We're going to get started with the service this morning. So if we can be seated, we'll start with the service this morning. Thank you. Just so that everyone is protected, we want you to keep your mask on during the service and just observe social distancing if you're not in the same household. So we just we'll keep everybody safe for this morning.
Checking. Check one.
Good morning. Isaiah 41:10 tells us, "Do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, because I am your Lord. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you in my righteous right hand." Lord Jesus, we thank you for today. We thank you, Lord, for putting us together. We are here for a purpose, and you know it very well. Lord, we exalt you, our gracious, merciful, loving, compassionate, and good God. Lord, I pray for the families, Lord. I pray, Lord, Father God, so that they would feel you, Lord. They'll feel your presence. I pray, Lord, Father God, so that they would not be discouraged, because this day was ordained by you. Lord, you said that when the time comes, you would be with us. And today we know that our sister is with you, Lord. And I pray so that none of us, Lord, Father God, will be sad. We would rejoice in the situation. We pray so that we would always rejoice in you, because that's what we are here for. We're not here to be happy, to be content, but we're here to be joyful. Lord, I pray so that we would always feel that you're right next to us. I pray, Lord, so that your compassionate hand, your hand of protection, we would feel them all the time. And I pray so that your grace would always surround us. But, Lord, most of all, I pray, Lord, Father God, so that we would feel you, Lord, as our comforter. You say the Holy Spirit, you will stand our comforter, the Holy Spirit. And we pray, Lord, Father God, so that in moments like this, we would let the Holy Spirit guide us, so that we would not look at our situation, but we would look at the destination of our sister, Lord. I know sometimes we're sad. We're sad because of the memories. But we Christians, we rejoice, because we know there's a party in heaven. We know our sister is being ushered in, and we have to rejoice. It's all about rejoicing, because we're changing address. We're not changing lives physically. And we thank you for all that's going to be doing, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for filling you, for filling your head of compassion. We thank you, Lord, for uplifting us in moments like this, because only you can do it, Lord. And Lord, we pray, Lord, Father God, so that the work that you were doing in Sister Marcia, Lord, Father God, somebody would pick up. Because you've called all of us to obey you and to love. And we pray so that many people would come to know you as the Lord and Savior from the work that Sister Marcia started doing. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, we pray with thanksgiving. Amen.
As we sing about the faithfulness of our God, He is faithful, hallelujah, through every hill and valley. Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. So great is thy faithfulness. Sing, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, do mercies I see. And all I have needed, thy hands have provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Summer and winter, springtime and harvest, sun, moon, stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy and love. Pardon for sin, pardon for sin, and a peace that endureth. Thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. He gives strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beasts. Let's lift our voice and sing, great is thy faithfulness. Oh, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. And all I have needed, thy hands have provided.
is thy faithfulness. Amen. We're going to have a scripture reading now from Gene Allen. We're going to sing a song, Because He Lives, and then Kenton Sr. is going to come and read Psalm 23. Come, Gene. Thank you so much.
Good morning, everyone. The scripture lesson is taken from John 14, verses 1 to 6. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. And whether I go, ye know, and the way ye know. I'm sorry. Thomas said unto him, Lord, we know not whether thou goest, and how can we know the way? Jesus said unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. If he know not me, he should have known my Father also, and from henceforth he know him and have seen him. Here endeth the reading of God's word.
And then as gives way to victory. I'll see the light of glory, and I'll know He lives because He lives. I can face tomorrow, and because He
Reading from Psalms 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want to be. I shall not be in want. He makes me down to lie in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in paths of righteousness for His name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I'll dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Still trying to come to grips with the fact that Marcia is no longer with us. It's still so surreal as I think back. Just a few weeks before her passing, Marcia and I had a long conversation. We talked about her plans for the fall, what she'd like to do, and get engaged with her agents. She was thinking about going upstate New York, doing certain things. Up there. She also talked about going into New England. So it was a good conversation, a great spirited conversation. So when I heard that Marcia wasn't well and Marcia passed, it was such a surprise to me, really a surprise. And as I start to reflect on our relationship, Marcia and I have known each other for years. And we really got to know each other when I moved to Miami in about 2003, and Marcia was the sales relations manager. Well, you know Marcia, she took charge. And she told me what to do, when to do it, how to do it. And I really felt comfortable having Marcia there as our sales relations manager. A few years after, an opportunity came up. Well, Marcia came from New York to Miami, and a few years after, an opportunity came up that we needed a manager in New York. And I right away said, oh, Marcia. Marcia would be the best person for that job. So I went to Marcia and said, Marcia, how would you like to go back to New York as district manager? Me, sir? No, sir. Me not going back to New York. It's too cold. It's too cold. Me not going back. I said, no, Marcia. It would be perfect. Well, after convincing, Marcia went back to New York as district manager for the Jamaica Tourist Board. It was perhaps one of the best decisions I ever made. Marcia took charge. Not only did she embrace the travel agent community and the diaspora community, they embraced her. And she was a true leader. She guided her team. You know, I still have visions. I've seen Marcia walking into an event with her team in tow. Chris Dobson on one side, her enforcer, Kent Ancina on the other side, the glamorous Victoria Harper one side, and they were just walking in, spewing so much confidence. Whenever I'd go to an event and Marcia was there in charge, her comment was like, "Don't worry, Mr. D, I have this covered. You don't have to worry about a thing." I loved her confidence. She, over the years, really established herself as Miss Jamaica in the Northeast. She did a superb job. She was admired by her competitors. She was admired by her peers. She was really a rock. We're going to sadly miss Marcia as part of the family. We are at the Jamaica Tourist Board. We're not just colleagues, but we're family. We look out for each other. We've been together for such a long time. And so, on behalf of your family, your JTB family, we say, rest in peace, Marcia. God be with you. You will never be forgotten.
Your memory will live on forever. Goodbye.
My dear friends and brothers and sisters in Christ, I am so sorry that I am not able to be with you today as you celebrate the beautiful life of our sister Marcia Sinclair, whose life has affected so many in your circle and others across the world. I'm thankful that I had a part of her journey, which began in a little Sunday school class at Bethany Fellowship, where I taught young teenagers. Marcia was a faithful member of that group and a ready participant in all of the activities of the group. I can't forget her smile. She had a confident smile which she wore all of her life. She had from early the characteristic of faithfulness, which I think was influenced by her godly father, Mr. Gladstone Sinclair, who is now also with the Lord. Brother Sinclair was never absent from any of the important meetings of our church. He was particularly faithful to the prayer meetings and the Bible studies. He was always an active learner and always participated in the major activities of our assembly. And Marcia seemed to have captured the spirit of faithfulness and integrity which marked the life of her dad. Her parents were a part of a nurture group that I later taught, and Marcia, now a young adult, also participated in this class. And it was very easy for me to transition from Marcia's Sunday school teacher to become Marcia's friend, a friendship that lasted for so many years and remained warm and true even in the times of her separation from Jamaica, in which we did not have a great deal of contact, but the love and the warmth remained the same throughout those years. Marcia maintained an integrity, a faithfulness, a sincerity, a spirit of excellence, which characterized her life and her work with the Jamaica Tourist Board. And I believe that her many years of faithfulness and of dedicated service were due to the fact that there was no dichotomy between her spiritual life and her secular role. Everything for her was spiritual. She served the board out of her service for Christ. The same ethics, the same Christian ethics that had informed all of her life were applied to the work that she did. She carried out all of her duties with that same spirit of excellence that marked her early life. Her career was one that brought glory to God and uplifted Jamaica to the world. A life that honors God and blesses a nation is a life worthy of emulation. Marcia has shared her faith in God by her faithfulness to that which was entrusted to her. I know that her soul now rests in peace, for she has fought a good fight. She has lived an exemplary and godly life and has left her mark among all those with whom she came in contact. So may we continue the work that she began and live with the same integrity and excellence that marked her, so that we will have a similar impact on our world. God bless you.
Good morning, family and friends of Marcia. Marcia and I met in Sunday school Bible class as teenagers, and we became very good friends while we were at the University of the West Indies, where Marcia worked, and where we did several classes together. We have been very good friends since, and I consider myself blessed to have been her friend. Marcia loved deeply and was fiercely loyal and generous. She was devoted to family. Once you were Marcia's friend, you got to know her family, her parents, her brothers, and their families, and her other friends, and even some of her co-workers. She was there for all of us, her family, and for us as friends, through thick and thin. Marcia always had our backs. Have no doubt, Marcia was independent, assertive, and very no nonsense. She spoke her mind, and she wasn't intimidated by anyone. She was hardworking to a fault, and even when she was unwell, she worked hard to complete all her assignments. She loved Jamaica, and she enjoyed her job at JTB. Others will say more about that. Marcia was reserved, but once she opened her heart and her personal space to you, she was always finding ways to show that she cared. I consider her to be one of my card friends and the giver of gifts. She sent cards on birthdays and any and every special occasion she could find. She was so organized that she would purchase those cards and mail them early to ensure that I received them on time. Being the perfectionist she was, she would be quite annoyed with the mail service when the cards came late. Marcia had a treat for me and members of my family on almost every trip she made to Jamaica. Over the years, we learned about each other's likes and made every effort to share gifts as tokens of affection and encouragement. Marcia's faith was anchored in the Jesus she loved. She talked about him a lot and about her understanding of how he was leading her at particular times. Over the years, Marcia and I prayed together many times, in personal visits, on the phone, via WhatsApp messages, and we were very grateful when WhatsApp came on, because those calls could sometimes be extremely long. We shared Bible verses and passages, as well as songs that encouraged us. If you knew Marcia long enough, you would know that she's not a complainer. Apart from the fact that she would be more focused on problem solving than complaining, Marcia usually understated how she was feeling. I was telling Frankie, my husband, the other day, that if Marcia said she was feeling some discomfort, I learned over time that it meant she was feeling very ill. If she said she was having some pain, she was often in intense pain. But she didn't want us to worry or to be bothered to try to assist. Early 2019, Marcia told me, after her diagnosis, that she was ready for any outcome of her illness, as her life was in God's hand. And I think many of you will know that this was not her first bout with this illness. She was to repeat that readiness several times from there. And yet I would say she was hopeful that she would beat the cancer. In our last conversation, 2 weeks prior to her passing, and in a WhatsApp message she sent me the following day, Marcia was very upbeat. I told her often that she was a trophy of God's grace and faithfulness, as she was such an encouragement to me during her illness. It was a phrase, the trophy of God's grace, that she used often to describe her mother and role model, who battled many illnesses and maintained her calm and her faith. Marcia, I believe, went the way she wanted to. I was stunned when Joseph, her brother, called me the news. I crumbled, actually. But I believe Marcia lived and exemplified this verse found in 2 Corinthians 4, 16. And I can imagine her saying, therefore, I do not lose heart. Even though my outward man is perishing, yet the inward man is being renewed day by day. Marcia's faith in Jesus sustained her so that she did not lose hope. I will miss my friend, but I know that she's absent from the body and present with the Lord. I grieve not as those who have no hope. I'm confident that we will meet again in the hereafter. Rest in peace, my beloved.
This is a tribute to Marcia Patricia Sinclair from Dr. Carole Guntley, CDJP. She regrets not being able to be here today, but has sent her heartfelt tribute. Life is a symphony, and friendship is its theme. Today, with a heavy heart, I'm saying goodbye to Marcia Patricia Sinclair, my friend, my sister, and colleague. I will miss and treasure both the professional and personal relationship Marcia and I shared, which started at the Jamaica Tourist Board for over 34 years. Marcia began her professional journey in tourism during my tenure as Director of Tourism. She joined the Director's Department as my private secretary. We connected instantly and forged a strong bond that endured until today. That bond was guided by our faith in God, which allowed us to steadfastly face the many challenges we met along the way. Marcia was passionate and driven, and our department worked tirelessly in our quest to contribute positively to Jamaica's growth and tourism development. Along the way, we shared many experiences fueled with laughter, tears, disappointments, and joys. We lived through natural disasters like major hurricanes and other challenges, but these challenges served to build our resilience. We enjoyed team-building strategies and other programs that enabled us to mold a great workplace. Marcia's contribution was pivotal to our success. Marcia did not just show up, she was present and was beside me and always at the center of my journey. She had her antenna tuned to local, regional, and international affairs, especially as they related to tourism. Marcia's desire to serve Jamaica was real and genuine. The Director of Tourism's department worked as a very close-knit team. Marcia was, as they say, the head cook and bottle washer, hands-on and willing to jump in at any time. She was the organizer of the department. Marcia ensured that we related well and performed so that the team dynamics thrived, and true to form, the team exceeded expectations. I must mention here that the team at the time consisted of Carol Samuels Johnson, Valerie Lynn, Dahlia Mattis, and intern Stephanie Gordon and Anne Philpotts. Marcia oversaw the daily operations of the department and liaised with local, international colleagues and organizations. She was trusted and respected by everyone. When she was transferred to the JTB New York office, we were very happy for her, but sad to see her go. We truly missed her, but she left a strong legacy behind, and we soldiered on, knowing that she was just a phone call away. Our loss was the JTB New York's gain. Her colleagues welcomed her with open arms, as did the North American Travel Trade, Tourism Associates, and the Caribbean diaspora. Marcia's dignity, presence, professionalism, and love for her country were evident to all who encountered her. Marcia loved her family dearly and always endeavored to look after their welfare, especially baby brother Andrew. She took great pride in watching Andrew rise to gain his pilot's license. Whenever she spoke of her family and Andrew, she beamed. I can see her smiling right now in front of me. What a smile. Marcy has left a legacy of professionalism, gentleness, kindness, decency, fairness, empathy, integrity, and love. She loved her God and served him devoutly. She kept her faith strong. She waned not in her personal challenges, nor through the challenging times that the world is facing now. Committed to Jamaica, to duty, till the end. It's not easy to have to say goodbye to my dear Marcia. But you know, I feel blessed. So blessed that God had given me a friend, a true friend. I will always treasure our long and special relationship. I will also cherish the memories we shared. We shared so many. But the happy and smiling ones, those are the ones that will ensure her memory lives on. Marcia Patricia Sinclair, God bless you as you continue on your spiritual journey. Your legacy lives on. I love you, my friend. God bless you.
Good morning, church. 2 years ago, at a setting similar to this, at the Thanksgiving service for Richard, I remarked that I'd come to realize that the passing of a sibling, for some reason, is more painful than that of a parent. Our dear father in 2002, and mom 4 years later in February 2016. Master's passing is just as tough. We know it's a path that we'll all have to walk someday, but it does hurt. It hurts hard. Of added significance is that on August 5th, 2020, there was not the usual social media posting on the anniversary of Richard's passing. Marcia always found the time and simply did not forget to highlight any and all of our family milestones. She was already being missed. Close friends and family who knew the Sinclair family knew of the outsized influence Marcia had on our family life. She was the firstborn over 60 years ago to Gladstone and Irma Sinclair, with 5 boys to follow over a 17-year span. That influence did not come from mere seniority. That influence came from an easy willingness to serve, a willingness to serve without prompting or reward. To wield the influence she had over 5 younger male siblings, I can safely say, came from a desire to see each of us achieve our full potential. She celebrated all our successes. If you were a colleague or a friend, you heard of her, brother's achievements. If you had a chance to visit her home in Fresh Meadows, you will note that she proudly and prominently displayed pictures of all her family, all her nieces and nephews. My daughter, Jodian, took her first baby steps in Master's apartment in Florida. Her love of all things family meant that our parents joined Marcia in Queens, New York in the late 1990s. Marcia quickly recreated the New York version of the Sinclair family home. Her home became the hub for the family, the Grand Central, the focal point for the family, the central sorting office. I understand that the daily early morning family devotions regained its fitting status, albeit without the full quorum. If you knew us well, you could understand why sentimental Marcia, steeped in tradition and symbolism, wished to create a New York version of the Sinclair family home of Tennessee Crescent in Duny Park and East Great Hill Circle in Avondale. We enjoyed the benefits of a large family. This despite the absence of the usual trappings of wealth. Our early years were filled with joy, laughter, and fellowship. Our home was always filled with neighborhood friends. What with five Sinclair boys, sufficient for our own football team, and a big sister in charge of our fan club, Marcia had no choice but to have a love for all sports. We grew up in a Christian home. We all attended Sunday school at Bethany Gospel Hall. And as we got home from school to home in Duny Park, and later Avondale, our mom was always there to ensure that a healthy dinner was provided and that homework was supervised. We were never hungry for love. We knew we were loved. I get the sense that as Marcia matured to a young adult, having moved on from Myrtle Grove High School to the now University of Technology in the early 1970s, and then to UWE in the early 1980s, she became increasingly aware of the positive impact that a good education, proper coaching, a good mentor, the positive impact of the church, and the fellowship of like-minded friends all could have on the growth and upward mobility of youths in the society. Marcia knew all too well of the pitfalls that may negatively impact the lives of her brother, of her brothers. She knew that despite the best efforts of a stay-at-home mom and the support of father stationed away from home for extended periods each month, that we could easily fall off the rails. She clearly volunteered to assist and to serve as an added buffer to all the challenges that life would come to throw at us. It is not surprising that the protective nature of all of her maternal instincts had its greatest impact on the lives of her three youngest siblings, Richard, Joseph, and Andrew. This is not to say that the older brothers, Patrick and Lyndon, did not feel her wrath. She wanted each of us to be the best versions of ourselves, to walk with the Lord and lead lives in line with the example set and the teachings of our humble parents. Our parents, I'm sure, were justly proud of the life Marcia had led. Her personal and professional career development were not diminished by the demands of her on her time. She absolutely loved her work. She was just as proud of Jamaica as she was of her parents and siblings. Just prior to my father's passing in November 2002, in one of his more lucid moments, my father, a man not of deep emotions, remarked how pleased he was with the progress of all his kids. He was also pleased of the help he got from the two ladies in his life, our mom and our dear sister, Marcia. He knew that he had run his race. He knew And it was up to him, that was up to us, to continue to lead good, clean, and productive lives. In fact, as we now put things into perspective, in the 2 weeks since Marcia's passing, we now realize that Marcia was indeed deeply saddened by our father's death. Marcia's willingness to serve her country through her work at the Jamaica Tourist Board, to contribute to a just cause, to contribute with a desire for shallow praises and recognition, all came from a deep and abiding respect as well as affection for her father. She shared his faith. As a firstborn, she saw at an early age his struggle at raising 6 kids. With the loss of Daddy Cinco, to say that Marcia doubled down on showering her love towards our mom is an understatement. Marcia left no stone unturned in ensuring that our mom was in attendance at gala events. Our mom was at Marcia's side at the most regal of events. Our mother, Irma Joyce, from the small district of Mines in the hills above Lawlands at Landover in St. Anne, Jamaica, rubbed shoulders with several dignitaries in high society. And Marcia made sure we had the pictures to prove same. In visits to Marcia's home subsequent to our mom's death in February 2016, she expressed how much our mom shared with her of her early life in St. Anne. My mom shared of her time with her father and the satisfaction she had felt with the successes of her children. Marcia would remark that whilst her mom suffered from all the health maladies of an advanced age, she would, before retiring to bed, pray for the light, for the Lord's guiding hand to lead in the lives of all her children, naming each by name with a specific reference to the issues we face. Our mom, and by extension Marcia, knew of our personal challenges and desires. Like our parents, our mom wished the best for us. Marcia was no different. Marcia could cook. In fact, she was great in the kitchen and she baked very well. Those who were fortunate enough from time to time to be on our mailing list for Christmas cakes, banana bread, carrot cake, and real macaroni and cheese, like our Jamaicans do it in an oven, can attest to this. She got this gift from her mother. As youngsters in Jamaica, we ate ackee and saltfish for years without ever knowing that you might find fish bones on your plate. The difference with Mom and Marcia's cooking, if there was any, was that Mom was a free hand, relying solely on judgment gained over the years, whilst Marcia usually stayed close to the script. Marcia got the hang of this much later. Another difference, perhaps stemming from my mother having to feed 6 kids, is that if we were hungry, we much preferred to have Mom in the kitchen. Mom would have food on the table in a flash, but with a host of pots and pans to clean up thereafter. Whereas Marcia would take perhaps all day, but the kitchen would be clean as a whistle. Even while the preparation continued, Marcia was ever a stickler for order and detail. Yes, Marcia was a stickler for detail. She loved her job. She was a proud ambassador for Brand Jamaica. It was not unusual for my mom to be awakened deep in the night by the lights from Marcia's little home office or the sounds of her voice while proofreading the latest report she had to deliver. Somehow, all reports were urgent and had to be delivered the next morning. Or some complaint had to have an urgent and concise reply. Marcia loved speaking of her country. She relished the opportunity that job afforded to meet and chat with our travel partners. At times, I heard the concern in her voice when she called me in Jamaica to ferret out information on breaking events that may have had an adverse impact on our team's hard-won efforts at making Jamaica the destination of choice in a competitive marketplace. The hospitality industry and the travel and airline industry have had a pivotal role in the professional careers of three members of our family. Marcia's general influence as our role model and mentor, as well as her particular influence on the younger members of the family, had a role to play in this development. She was instrumental in first, Richard, securing employment at American Airlines in Kingston, and similarly, Andrew, who gained employment with Air Jamaica. To hear them speak for hours on the airline and travel industry was an experience, with the site for these lengthy conferences usually being Marcia's apartment. These meetings would continue well into the night. And of course, the frequent topic being the demise of our national airline. Andrew's career at Air Jamaica between 1993 and 2010 was essentially crafted by Marcia. At an early age, with Marcia fresh out of UTEC, she assisted with Andrew's primary schooling. That support continued when Marcia was relocated to the JTD's office in Miami. She, along with her brother Patrick, were crucial to Andrew achieving his dream of becoming a commercial airline pilot. They assisted with his training at flight school in Florida. Andrew completed his first flight with Air Jamaica in February 2000. Fittingly, that first flight was Flight 11, Kingston, Montego Bay, and then on to New York, JFK, landing safely at just after 9 p.m. We are of the view that Marcia would have wanted to be on the tarmac to welcome in that flight. She, however, settled with conducting a detailed debriefing later at the airport hotel. Marcia's passing just over 2 weeks ago has again brought home the fact that each of us gathered here today should schedule some time to communicate with a loved one. To communicate with a loved one while we still have the time, and perhaps just to say how meaningful and significant they had an impact in our lives. Sadly, we will not get that chance with Marcia. Marcia is in a better place. It is God's will, as our dad would say. We all know of Marcia's faith in our Lord and Savior. We know, just as our mom, that she prayed without ceasing. It is up to us, Patrick, Lyndon, Joseph, and Andrew, to carry on, to complete our life's journey as they would wish.
Is there anyone here from the Caribbean Tourism Organization that is, thank you so much, come now.
Good morning, everyone.
Morning.
As Donnie said, Marcia was, Miss Jamaica. And as, you know, a lot of us who've been in the industry, she recognized how much she loved her country. Also equally, within the region, we realized she had an equal love for the Caribbean as well. As Caribbean destinations, we did not see her as a competition, but she embraced all of us, and we want to say thank you so much to her for the knowledge that she imparted in us, and also we appreciate the fellowship that she had with us as well. I've been asked to read a letter of condolence from the Acting Secretary General for the Caribbean Tourism Organization. And it reads, the member countries, allied members, and staff of the Caribbean Tourism Organization join family, friends, and loved ones in mourning the passing of Marcia Sinclair, sales relations manager at the Jamaica Tourist Board office in New York. Marcia was a great ambassador for Jamaica and the Caribbean, and her passion for promoting her country and the region was unquestionable. This fact was reinforced by her quest to ensure that Jamaica would remain at the forefront when it was safe to travel again. Apology for that. This fact was reinforced by her quest to ensure that Jamaica would remain at the forefront when it was safe to travel again. When COVID-19 forced the closure of Jamaica's border to international travel. As always, Marcia leveraged her knowledge of the industry and quickly began devising innovative ways to engage with travel agents, tour operators, and other industry partners. Her passion for Jamaica and her tireless effort are exemplified by the fact that her last major action was the planning of an online event for travel agents and other industry partners celebrating Jamaica's independence. Marcia was unapologetic in her support for the CTO and its program in the U.S., ensuring Jamaica's participation in key events. It was at these times that her unflattering passion for the region would be clearly demonstrated. On behalf of the Chairman of the Council of Ministers and the Commissioners of Tourism, the Chairman of the Board of Directors, and the entire CTO family, I wish to extend our deepest sympathy to her family and friends and the entire tourism fraternity in Jamaica and the Caribbean. Sincerely, Neil Walters, Acting Secretary General for the Caribbean Tourism Organization. May her soul rest in peace. Thank you.
That grace.
I knew Marcia. She came to our church for several years, and Marcia used to always sit in the back. And I'd always be coming in and walking out, and she'd always be the first that I'd see and the last that I'd see. And man, did I love her. What a spirit she had. You know, I'm not just saying this because most of us are here in this room that are Jamaican, but I've never met a Jamaican that I did not like, and she was on the top of my list. I tell you what, she was what a sweet, wonderful woman of God. Faithful, devoted, and we are going to miss her. But I want us to go into the Word of God for a moment. When I say that, most of the people at Bethlehem get a little scared because a moment can turn into a memory. But I do want to look into the Scripture and see what the Bible says about us dealing and facing death in our life. And by the way, thank you for all of those heartfelt tributes. I thought they were done with such incredible excellence. And what a wonderful way to tribute someone so wonderful and dear to us. But here's what it says. It says, "For we say unto you, the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with a voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. So shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words." Paul the Apostle is speaking to a group of people that were greatly persecuted by non-Christians. Paul the Apostle had actually planted one of his first churches in a place called Thessalonica, northern Greece. And as he went there, he encountered incredible persecution and pushback from the gospel. It was a wonderful, beautiful city, and it was made up of many, many cultures. And as a result of that, there were many religions, and there were some people that embraced another religion and got very angry at Paul the Apostle for coming in and telling them that Jesus was the way, the truth, and the life, and that no man would go to the Father but through Jesus Christ. And so they ran him out of town. They literally, after 3 weeks, ran him out of town. And now Paul the Apostle gets report back from his sons in the faith, Silas and Timothy, that the church that he had planted within 3 weeks was flourishing and growing. It was a powerful church. They were experiencing the power of God in such a way that the Bible says that when they began to preach the gospel rang out so clear and so powerful that it not only rang out in that city, but it rang out in that region, and they became, the Bible says, a model to all the other people. And Paul the Apostle said, man, he was so excited to hear that he tells these people, listen to what he says. He writes a letter. He finds out how well they're doing. And I can see Paul the Apostle running into his bedroom or his office or wherever and getting out a piece of paper and starting to write down the first book of Thessalonians. And he begins to talk to these people from his heart. And he says, I remember you always. He says, and I remember the work that was produced by your faith. And he said, not only that, but I remember the fact that you've been prompted to do this by your love for God and for other people. And then he said this, and he said, your endurance and your perseverance that has come through the hope that you have in your salvation. And you know, he's talking to this group of people that are being so persecuted for their faith. They're going through suffering in their life. Now, I don't know about you, but I have not really been persecuted for my faith. Not yet. But I have gone through suffering in my life. In fact, I lost my dad. I lost my stepdad. I lost my brother recently. Lost a lot of people in my family that I loved deeply. And that's a part of living in this world, suffering, and realizing that we're not going to live on this earth forever. How does a person go through grief in their life? How does a person deal with suffering in their life? How does a person go through pain in their life? How does a person go through when they prayed about certain things and maybe God's decided to do it a different way? How do they deal with all of the problems of their life? Well, Paul the Apostle says they deal with it with hope. And so the 1 Thessalonians is all about hope. He's really encouraging all of the Christians that he had just planted the church in, that they should recognize that they need to have an eternal perspective in life. And friend, if you don't have an eternal perspective in life, when life ends on this side of heaven and you don't have an eternal perspective, you're going to be, as the Bible says, men that are most miserable, women that are most miserable. But Paul the Apostle tells these people, he says, I know you're going through suffering and pain and persecution, but I don't want you to be ignorant about those that fall asleep. Notice the term he uses, fall asleep. He says, our body falls asleep. But our spirit, according to Paul the Apostle, when we're Christians, our spirit directly goes to be in the very presence of the Lord. He said to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And he says, so I don't want you to be ignorant about this. I don't want you to weep or mourn like the rest of the world weeps or mourns. Now I've been to a lot of funerals. I've actually been pastoring this church for 27 years. I've been in ministry for 35 years. I started in ministry when I was 1 year old, right? And so I've been around a lot of funerals, whether they were funerals for my family members or funerals for people in the church. And I've been to funerals for people that were not believers. And there's been a marked, distinctive difference between people of faith, people of hope, people of love, and people that don't have faith. They grieve in such a way that breaks your heart because they have no hope. But Paul the Apostle tells the Christian that we are not to grieve like the rest of the world because we have got hope. And hope is not this maybe. You know, see, there's this definition that we have today in our world when it comes to hope, that hope is maybe. It's like, I hope I'm going to go to Jamaica again, to Ocharia, Dunn's River. Eat some jerk chicken and gory goat mouth, everything good, everything. I love Jamaican food, and one day I'm believing that I'm going to go back to Jamaica. Now, I'm certainly hoping behind those masks you're smiling a little bit when I'm talking. If you smile a little bit with me, just go like this. That's a smile. Thank you very much. Make me feel better now. But it's not this maybe. I might go to Jamaica. I might have a good meal. And brother, you were really making me hungry when you're talking about all of that Jamaican wonderful food. But Christian biblical hope is not a maybe. Christian biblical hope is an assurance, a confidence in the promises that God has made that it will come to pass. Not maybe, but it will come to pass. So Paul the Apostle says, I don't want you to grieve like the rest of the world when you lose somebody that you love. Why? Because we have a confident expectation. We're living by faith. And what is faith? Faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things we cannot see right now. And so Paul the Apostle says that as a Christian, when we fall asleep, our body falls asleep, our spirit goes directly to heaven. But there's coming a day when even our bodies will be resurrected. That's the hope of the resurrection. Peter says we've been born again into a living hope. It's not a dead hope, it's a living hope. And we have this inheritance that's kept in heaven, and we're shielded by faith until the coming of our full salvation. And so I want to just encourage all of us here, wherever you are in your faith journey, and I certainly hope that you've embraced Jesus as your Savior and your Lord, because we're looking at a world that's kind of upside down today. It's going crazy. I mean, here we are wearing masks. Here we are looking at people that are passing away, and we're wondering what's happening in this world. Friend, I want to tell you something. We have nothing to fear because we are people of faith. We are people of love, and we are people of hope. And that hope gives us this firm assurance that everything's going to be okay in the end, because God has it all under control. This is God's timetable. God knows what he's doing. He knows what he's doing in my life. He knows what he's doing in your life. He certainly knew what he was doing in Marcia's life, and his will was done, and now she's in the presence of Almighty God. And it's this hope that we have that when we fall asleep in our body, that we'll be present with the Lord, that gives us the courage to face whatever we have to face in our life. And the truth of the matter is, right now, Marcia is dancing on streets of gold. You say, well, come on, Pastor Steve. You know, that's a fairy tale. You're just holding on to something. Listen, I let me tell you. When I was 19 years old, I was running from God. I was a Jonah. I was running from God. God had called me into the ministry when I was a little boy. And I didn't want to have anything to do with it. I wanted to party, party, party. 19 years old, I was running from God. I was in Queens, and I got into a bad car accident. I was being rushed to the hospital, and I heard a voice. It wasn't an audible voice, but it was a voice in my heart, and it sounded a whole lot like my mother's voice. You know what I'm talking about? Anybody have a Jamaican mama? You know what I'm talking about? They made you go to church. You going to church. My mother made me go to church. I sat right there in the front row, right there. Every Sunday morning, no matter where I was, on Sunday, I had to sit right there in the front row of this church since I was 6 years old. And I heard a voice, and it was a voice, I believe it was a voice of God, and that voice said, if you died today, do you know for sure that you would go to heaven? And then I'm going to tell you something. That rocked my world. That shook me, because I wasn't ready to meet God. I was running from God, but God gave me that second chance in my life to say, God, this world has nothing to offer me. I mean, who in the world could give me enough money, whatever it was, to make me have the peace that I needed to know that if I died right there, I could have died and stood before God Almighty at that very moment. And let me tell you, that was enough for me to come to church on Sunday morning and listen a little bit more careful to the preacher when he preached. And I'll never forget that day. It was a July day. I was sitting right there in that seat, and the preacher was preaching, and he was preaching as long as I usually do, and I just couldn't wait for him to stop preaching, not because I wanted to leave, but because I wanted to run to the altar, not because I wanted to leave and forget about what he said, but I was so stricken in my heart because I had come face to face with death, and I really didn't know where I was going, and that, frankly, shook my world. When the preacher finished preaching, he always, my preacher, my pastor, I loved him. He was a father to me in the faith. He'd always, at the end of every sermon, at the end of every service, he'd issue the invitation. You've been there. You know what I'm talking about. He'd issue the invitation. If you don't know, if you died today, and you need Jesus Christ to forgive you of your sins, then I'm inviting you right now to get out of your seat and come forward. They don't do that much anymore, but I still do. And come forward and give your life to Jesus. And ask him to forgive you of your sins. And let him come into your heart. And I'll never forget that day. I didn't walk to the altar. I crawled to the altar. I just fell off my seat and crawled to this altar right here when I was 19 years old. And let me tell you something, I'm 57 years old, and please, just tell me, you don't look 57, just lie to me, do anything, please. That's the only time we're allowed to lie to the preacher. And God so changed my life. I mean, Jesus gave me a peace that no one can rob. For all these years, close to 40 years, I've gone through ups and downs and problems and trials, and I faced things and seen my family members go on to be with the Lord, but there's a peace, there is a hope, there is an assurance, there is a confidence that cannot be shaken, because my assurance is in a Savior who died and rose on the third day. Friends, if they could find the body of Jesus, they could disprove Christianity, but there's an empty tomb in Israel to prove that my Savior lives. And because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives. When that time comes and I've got to cross that river, I know where I'm going now. I know who holds my eternity in his hands. And because of that, I have peace. And because of that, I have an assurance that cannot be taken from me. And so as we gather today, what a beautiful tribute. Well done. Well done. What a beautiful tribute to a beautiful woman of God. Well done, Marcia. You have lived your life. You have run your race. One of the pastors said, you have fought your fights. You have kept the faith. You've showed the world, you've showed your relatives, your friends, your neighbors, you've shown them all. This is how a Christian warrior faces her fights. This is how a Christian runs her race. And this is how a Christian keeps her faith. Not just in the good times, not just on the mountaintop, but as she walks through the valley of the shadow of death, she feared no evil. For she knew that God was with her every step of the way. And Jesus welcomed her home. You know, the other day, I lived near Long Beach. Anybody know where Long Beach is? You have a really pretty beach. The water's really clear. I want to go to Jamaica. Anybody else want to go to Jamaica? You made me long for Jamaica today. I go every year because before the crisis happened, I was going every year because we have a ministry in Jamaica. It's in Ocho Rios, and it's called Teen Challenge. And we've helped to build this beautiful building. And then the government gave us all this land to be able to actually build a Teen Challenge center. And so I go back there all the time, and it's just wonderful, beautiful. But when I'm not in Jamaica, I try to go to Long Beach. Not even close. The water's not even close. But I was walking on the shore the other day, and I said to the Lord, I said, Lord, would you give me a longing for home? This is not my home. And I don't want to get so comfortable here that I would forget that I'm just passing through, that I'm a stranger in this world. And I'm just passing through. And as long as I keep my focus on heaven and I keep my focus on God, he's my everything, no matter what happens all around me, coronavirus, the economy, all the stuff that's happening around the world, it can really get you scared, create such anxiety. Or you can just say, Lord, I'm just passing through. On my way home. Jesus said it this way as I close, I promise you. I kind of close three times or four times. No, I'm just kidding. Jesus said this. He said, don't let your heart be troubled. Don't let it happen. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house. In my Father's house, there are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. That's it. This is it. You live here 70, 80, 90, maybe 100 years. You're done. You're finished. It's over. He said, I would have told you that. He said, but he said, I'm going away to prepare a place for you so that where I am, you might be also. I don't know about you, but today's a sobering day. You know, the Bible says better to go to a funeral than to go to a wedding. Because a funeral is a moment where we all stop to think about our own mortality. And we all start to thinking about, do I have faith? Am I a person of faith? And so as we conclude this memorial service, my heart, Bethlehem Assembly of God, we're praying for you. We love you. And we want you to know that there's going to be a couple of days after this and beyond where you're going to be a little sad. So we're here for you, and we stand with you, and we pray for you. But the last thing I want to do before we leave this place is to make sure every one of us in this room, we're just ready for home. Because, friend, God is so real. And Jesus loves you so much. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. God doesn't want you to perish. He wants you to have everlasting life. And once you receive it, no one can steal it from you. And once you have it, you have hope that goes beyond this life. Can we all pray together? Would you just bow your heads and let's pray together right now. Let's ask the Lord to help us to be people of faith. That we would invite God to be the center of our life and invite Christ to be the Lord and Savior of our life. So, Lord, I pray for this precious family and these precious friends. Lord, I pray that you would comfort their heart and their souls, Lord. God, I pray that you would give them peace to know. I know where Marcia is. She's in heaven because she believed. And you said, if we believe, Lord, we'll not perish, but we'll have everlasting life, Lord. And everlasting life began the moment she accepted you as her Savior and her Lord. And I just pray, Lord, that you touch every one of us in this room today and help us all to embrace faith in your word. And so maybe you are here today, your head is bowed, your eyes are closed today. It's between you and God. And I know that if we ask Marcia, what do you want us to do at your funeral? I guarantee you she'd say, tell them that Jesus loves them. Tell them that there's a real heaven. Tell them that Jesus died for their sins. Tell them he rose again. Tell them that he's seated at the right hand of the Father in glory. Tell them that they also need to receive Christ as their Savior. So I'm going to give you that opportunity right now just to pray. You say, Pastor Steve, I'm not certain that if I died today, I'd go to heaven. And I want to know. I want to be sure that when my body falls asleep, my spirit's going straight to heaven. I want that assurance. I want that hope. I want that peace. You know, as a sign of faith, and I know a lot of churches do a lot of different things, but in this church, one sign of faith is a raised hand. You know what a raised hand is? It's a sign of surrender. It's a sign of accepting. I'm reaching out to God. And so you say, Pastor, would you pray for me right now? I want Jesus Christ to be the Lord of my life and the Savior of my soul. I want you to raise your hand right now. I want to pray for you. God bless you, 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 bless you. Well, why don't we pray right now and invite Christ to be our Savior and our Lord right now? And if you do that, he said, behold, I stand at the door and I knock. If any man would open the door, friend, the door handle's on the inside of your heart. And when you open that door, the Bible says, he said, I will come in and I'll never leave you nor forsake you. And so that's it. You might say, that's pretty simple. Oh, yes. He did all the heavy lifting. Jesus did all the heavy lifting. He went to the cross. He died on the cross. He took your sins. He bore the penalty of your sins. It's called justification. And he took it all upon himself so that now you could be free from the penalty of sin so that you can have eternal life and be in heaven with God who is holy. So let's all, as another sign of faith, that act of faith, to pray this simple prayer, all of us together in this place. Let's do this out loud. I want you to pray with me. Lord Jesus, thank you that you conquered death at your resurrection. I ask you right now, forgive me of my sins and be my Savior and my Lord. Come into my heart and into my life. I accept you with all of your wonderful promises today. You are my Lord and my Savior. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You know, the Bible says all of heaven rejoices when one person turns to God. Marcy is in heaven right now. I'm not sure she could see, but if she can, she's dancing right now because somebody in this room said, I want to be ready to meet Jesus. And she said, oh, good, I'm going to get to see them too. And she's clapping. Come on, let somebody clap right now and say, thank you, Lord, for Marcia and her life. And thank you, Lord, for those, even today, who have given their life to the Lord. We thank you for that. And we ask, Lord Jesus, now that you would bless us. In Jesus' name, amen. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you and make his face to shine upon you. The Lord lift up his countenance to you and the Lord give you shalom peace. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen and amen. God bless you.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my life thou hast taught me to say, it is well in my soul, it is well with my soul, it is well with my soul, it is well, it is well with my soul. With my soul, did it.